Okay, the next item of business is a statement by Shona Robison on minimum unit pricing of alcohol. The Deputy First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement. Therefore, there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Shona Robison, Deputy First Minister, around 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Members will be aware that my colleague Elena Whittam resigned earlier this week due to health reasons, and she has been instrumental in progressing our work on alcohol, and I'm sure members will join me in wishing her well. Presiding Officer, I recall making a statement to this chamber on the 21st of November 2017 on minimum unit pricing and our intention to reduce some of the harms caused in Scotland by alcohol. In May 2018, following the agreement of this Parliament, Scotland made history by becoming the first country in the world to introduce the policy. Having led the introduction of the policy, it is with great pleasure that I make this statement today on the future of minimum unit pricing of alcohol in Scotland. I'm clear that alcohol continues to cause significant health harm to too many people in our country. The latest figures by the National Records of Scotland show that there were 1,276 alcohol-specific deaths in 2022. I'd like to take this opportunity to extend my deepest sympathy to all those affected by the loss of a loved one through alcohol. We as a government are determined to do all we can to reduce alcohol harm. I announced back in 2017 our intention to introduce the policy as soon as we could. Following the delay caused by several years of litigation through the Scottish courts, the European Court of Justice and the UK Supreme Court. The minimum unit pricing legislation came into force on the 1st of May 2018 and contains, as members will already know, a sunset clause, which means that the legislation will cease to have effect unless the Scottish Parliament votes to continue it. In September last year, the Scottish Government published our report on the effect of minimum unit pricing in its first 5 years of operation. In order to inform this report, Public Health Scotland were tasked with leading an independent evaluation of minimum unit pricing, an evaluation commended by internationally renowned public health experts, including Sir Michael Marmot and Sally Caswell. Public Health Scotland's final findings were that overall the evidence supports that MUP has had a positive impact on health outcomes, namely a reduction in alcohol attributable deaths and hospital admissions, particularly in men and those living in the most deprived areas, and therefore contributes to addressing alcohol-related health inequalities. There was no clear evidence on substantial negative impacts on the alcohol drinks industry or of social harms at the population level. During the study period of the evaluation, it's estimated that MUP reduced alcohol attributable deaths by 13.4%, that's 156 a year, and was likely to have reduced hospital admissions wholly attributable to alcohol by 4.1% compared to what would have happened if MUP had not been in place. Running in tandem to the evaluation was also a review of the level of minimum unit price. In order to inform this review, the Scottish Government commissioned the University of Sheffield Alcohol Research Group, who are experts in this field, to undertake new modelling. Their research suggests that if MUP is to maintain the current level of benefits, the evaluation was able to find at 50 pence, it should increase to at least 60 pence per unit due to inflation. However, Scotland is facing a growing burden of disease in the next 20 years, and I know that all members will agree that action is needed to reduce the causes and effects of ill health in Scotland. Presiding Officer, I'm pleased to be able to update the Chamber today about the conclusion of our review of minimum unit pricing and to set out the next steps for the policy. Cabinet has now met and discussed all of the available evidence, including the recently held public consultation, and have come to a final decision. I can confirm it is our intention to lay draft orders before Parliament to continue minimum unit pricing beyond the 30th of April and to set the price per unit at 65 pence. I know that some people don't agree with minimum unit pricing, and we have considered their concerns and views in reaching this position. I also note concerns from business and industry regarding some aspects of minimum unit pricing. And whilst it's my view that these decisions are unlikely to have a significant effect on the alcohol industry and retailers as a whole, and to date evidence suggests there's not been a significant impact on these business groups, I do understand the concerns raised. We've considered the important role that alcohol production and sales play in Scotland, particularly important to the economies of our rural communities and for tourism. The evidence suggests that there will not be a significant impact on these businesses and our world-leading alcoholic drinks industry. Many business stakeholders told us that implementing any price change quickly may be difficult. So I'm pleased to say that in addressing these concerns, if Parliament agrees to the order increasing the minimum price to 65 pence per unit, this will not take effect until the 30th of September. We've listened to the views of business on this, including the refreshed regulatory review group, and agree that this implementation window is necessary to allow them to take steps to prepare for this change. Presiding Officer, whilst this statement is an update on minimum unit pricing, I recognise that MUP is not a silver bullet in itself. Whilst we must try to prevent people from experiencing alcohol-related harm in the first place, for those who are already drinking at higher levels, including people with alcohol dependency, specialist treatment and support is vital. The Scottish Government continues to take action to ensure people who require treatment and support in relation to alcohol can receive it. We're providing £112 million this year to alcohol and drug partnerships, and as part of that funding, we've set out the need to invest in specific initiatives such as stabilisation and crisis management for alcohol. We continue to see expansion in local assertive outreach services, which should also increase the numbers of people being offered treatment. We've asked Public Health Scotland to investigate the reduction in numbers for referrals to treatment services, and we need to make sure that referrals are made wherever appropriate and that there is capacity within services to meet people's needs. It's vital that we know what lies behind the data. Last autumn, we published our Workforce Action Plan for Alcohol and Drug Services to help shape recruitment, retention and service design. It sets out the key actions that we'll deliver over the next 3 years to address challenges experienced by the drugs and alcohol sector's workforce. Presiding Officer, I'm pleased to confirm the Scottish Government's decisions on MUP. These decisions are estimated by the Sheffield modelling already mentioned to avert an additional 60 alcohol-specific deaths and 774 fewer hospital admissions in the first year, not to mention the significant public health benefits we expect where alcohol is a contributor to causes of death and ill health. I would also particularly like to thank the many stakeholders in the alcohol industry, retail, tourism and public health, who have provided their views on MUP. These have supported our considerations around this decision. We will lay the orders before Parliament on the 19th of February, and I look forward to engaging with the committee further on this matter. Presiding Officer, alcohol harm remains a significant issue in Scotland. It continues to contribute to worsening health outcomes, and the decision to continue MUP and to increase the price shows that Scotland continues to be world-leading in improving the health of the people in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. The Deputy First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes, after which we'll need to move to the next item of business. Members wishing to ask a question who haven't already done so should press the request to speak buttons now. And I call Sandish Gohani.
Thank you. A question of interest as a practising NHS GP. Cabinet Secretary, you falsely accused me of not believing the evidence. Perhaps it is just a lack of understanding on your part, given the government had to change
their
release due to my complaint. Let's start with alcohol-related deaths. They're at a 14-year high in Scotland, and even a novice statistician would tell you hospitalisation data was not statistically significant. There are 40 studies in the evaluation of MUP, and only one claimed a reduction in deaths. Saying MUP has reduced deaths is not accurate, as it was an estimate based on statistical modelling, and if compared to Northern Ireland and not England, would have shown MUP caused deaths. The number of people seeking help for alcohol reduced by 40%, along with referrals to alcohol treatment. The purpose of a policy such as MUP should surely have been to reduce consumption of alcohol by those who are dependent drinkers. And Public Health Scotland's own data shows those with alcohol dependence are foregoing food. MUP is not the magic bullet that the Scottish Government are continuing to laud. So, if MUP was not designed to help those with alcohol dependence, what has the Scottish Government done to mitigate the harms that were obviously going to happen to them over the last 5 years? And what is the Scottish Government's policy for dependent drinkers that you have clearly abandoned?
Deputy First Minister.
Let me first start by quoting from Justina Murray, who is the Chief Executive of Scottish Families Affected by Alcohol and Drugs. And she said in response to Sandesh Gulhani, "I think you're possibly the only person in the room who doesn't believe the evidence. You know, we've lost over 11,000 people specifically to alcohol over the past decade. Families really don't understand why this is still being debated." I think Justina Murray encapsulates my feelings very well indeed. In relation to alcohol-specific deaths, for the evaluation, the question is not whether deaths went up or down, it's whether deaths changed compared to what would have happened if MUP had not been in place. And it's likely that without MUP, tragically, we would have experienced an even greater number of alcohol-specific deaths. That has been echoed by public health experts, the experts, such as Michael Marmot, in the letter written to The Lancet, which said, and I'm sure being a doctor, Sandesh Gulhani will know about The Lancet and the importance of The Lancet, which said policymakers can be confident that there are several hundred people with low incomes in Scotland who would have died as a result of alcohol, who are alive today as a result of minimum unit pricing. Presiding officer, I know who I listen to, and that's the public health experts. And I think we'll leave Sandesh Gulhani to talk for himself.
Thank you. Carol Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I associate myself with the remarks of the Deputy First Minister on behalf of Scottish Labour, wish Elena Witham well, and thank her for her work in this area. Can I also thank her for sight of her statement? As per the evidence, Scottish Labour accepts that minimum unit pricing has a role to play in tackling alcohol harms. But we do believe this must be part of a wider package of measures over and above. And this is a position shared by 30 public health-related organisations and charities. Does the Deputy First Minister agree that steps must be taken to explore how the additional revenue raised by minimum unit pricing can be recouped and invested into tackling alcohol harms in Scotland?
Deputy First Minister.
So, first of all, let me welcome Carol Morgan's support, I think, in principle for the policy. And I agree with her. As I said in my statement, it's not the silver bullet. There are many other things that have to be done. I talked about the services that are being delivered, particularly for those who are alcohol dependent. So all of those things are important. In terms of the public health levy, which I think she was alluding to, as she will be aware, and I recognise Labour's support for this, we have set out that we will give due consideration to a public health supplement, which of course was in place previously, I think between 2012 and 2015. But we need to consult on that. We need to take into account the many other aspects in the regulatory frameworks that are going on at the moment, not least minimum unit pricing, but also other regulatory issues that are being looked at. We need to look at that in the round. So I have been meeting with business organisations, and colleagues have been meeting with public health organisations, and we will look at all of that in order to come to the conclusions that well in advance of the budget later this year around how to proceed. And we look forward to working in a constructive way with Carol Mochan and others around these matters.
Claire Hawkey to be followed by Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I refer members to my register of interest. I hold a bank nurse contract with Greater Glasgow and Clyde NHS. The Deputy First Minister has already quoted some of the evidence that this Parliament's Health, Social Care and Sport Committee took on Tuesday on Scotland's minimum unit pricing policy. And we heard from numerous stakeholders who spoke of the impact minimum unit pricing has had in reducing consumption, hospital admissions and deaths. Indeed, a Public Health Scotland and University of Glasgow study indicated a reduction of 13.4% in deaths, wholly attributed to alcohol consumption in the first 2.5 years after minimum unit pricing was introduced. Can the Deputy First Minister outline any further evidence which highlights the benefits of this policy?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, can I say, as Claire Hawkey will know, Public Health Scotland was commissioned to carry out a comprehensive and independent evaluation of MUP, which looked at the health impacts of minimum unit pricing as well as the wider social and economic impacts. And that wide-ranging evaluation covered the first 5 years of the policy's implementation. I then made reference in my previous answer to the public health experts who have commented on that evaluation. I mentioned Sir Michael Marmot, Sally Caswell, but also Ian Gilmer, Martin McKee, and that they are commending of the methodology and approach taken. I think it's also worth noting, as I'm sure Claire Hawkey will be more than aware of, that other countries have since followed suit with the policy of minimum unit pricing and implementing it within their jurisdictions. And I think that wealth of evidence, not just from Scotland, but from across the world, will help us in terms of the policy going forward.
Thank you. A bit more brevity in questions and the responses. I now call Tess White and Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm aware that the Cabinet Secretary has had to step in at the last minute to replace Michael Matheson, so may not be aware of all the facts. The facts are Scotland has experienced a 25% increase in alcohol-related deaths in the past 3 years alone. Fact, in the past 10 years, the number of people accessing alcohol treatment services has gone down by 40%. Fact. Is the Cabinet Secretary really trying to tell us, and with great pleasure, that a huge hike in drink pricing and a cost of living crisis is the best solution?
Deputy First Minister.
I don't know if Jackson Carlaw is in the chamber, but all I can do is to reflect with an element of sadness how far we've travelled from the very constructive, evidence-led approach taken by the likes of Jackson Carlaw, who set politics aside to support minimum unit pricing when it was introduced. And in terms of being in full command of the facts, I think Tess White should perhaps remember that it was me that took minimum unit pricing through this Parliament way before Tess White was a member in here. So I am very much aware of the facts. And at no point have I stated that somehow minimum unit pricing is a magic bullet. In fact, I just said to Carol Mochan in recognition that it is one part of the jigsaw of how we tackle alcohol-related harm. I also answered to her colleague the complex issue of alcohol-related deaths and why the evaluation takes account of the impact of other issues as well, not least in terms of the COVID years, and the evaluation took account of the COVID years. I also answered the issue around referral to treatment services, that we need to understand why there is a reduction in people being referred to treatment services, which is why Public Health Scotland have been asked to investigate all of that. I said that in my statement. If Tess White had been listening,
thank you, Deputy First Minister. I'm going to have to speed things along a bit. There's a lot of interest in asking questions. I want to get through as many as I can. Next, Emma Harper, to be followed by Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I remind Chamber I am currently a registered nurse with the Nursing and Midwifery Council. The Cabinet Secretary mentioned other countries. The Northern Territory Government in Australia introduced a minimum unit price for alcohol in the same year as Scotland. So how does Scotland's experience from then to now reflect with other countries who have taken such an approach? And has the Government considered any international learnings that might be applied here?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, thanks to Emma Harper for pointing out, of course, that many countries have followed Scotland's lead on minimum unit pricing. other countries have introduced other pricing policies, Ireland, Wales, Scotland, of course, has led the way, including the substantive evaluation of the operation of MUP, which I'm sure others will look to. I think many other countries are considering their approaches and will look at our uprating of the price as part of that. For instance, in an article published by the Public Health Association Australia, it noted a view that they consider Scotland's approach to evaluation to be credible and it should give confidence to parliamentarians in Scotland. In a separate publication in South Africa, academics have considered the experience of MUP in Scotland. And so whether it's Australia or whether it's South Africa, we are very keen to work on the international arena to share some of that best practice.
Thank you. Paul Sweeney to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I also want to extend my best wishes to the member for Carrick-Cumlick and Doon Valley. I did appreciate her collegiate approach and indeed her personal passion to tackle Scotland's drug death crisis. Labour does agree with the Cabinet Secretary that minimum unit pricing is not a silver bullet to tackle alcohol-related harm. However, if the government is really believing that they can undertake specialist treatment and support as important parts of our efforts to reduce harms caused by alcohol, why have they cut the alcohol and drug treatment funding by £46 million in real terms over the last 5 years?
Deputy First Minister.
So can I first of all welcome the comments by Elena Whittam. They're very welcome indeed. In terms of the silver bullet, as I said earlier on, I accept what Paul Sweeney is saying. It is not a silver bullet, but it is part of the armoury, if you like, to tackle alcohol-related harm. In terms of specialist treatment, we're providing £112 million this year to alcohol and drug partnerships. And as part of that funding, we've set out the need to invest in specific initiatives such as stabilisation and crisis management for alcohol. I'm sure Paul Sweeney will be aware that there are some innovative projects that are looking at those who are alcohol dependent, and actually some of the evaluation from that is very interesting indeed. I, as I said to Carol Malkin, I'm keen, as Elena Whittam did, to try and build a broad coalition around some of the measures we need to take, because I think it's in all of our interest to tackle what has been a scourge in our society for too long.
And John Mason to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you. One of the concerns about minimum unit pricing was that it would just boost the profits of the supermarkets. Can the Deputy First Minister say anything about how this could be tackled, for example, by a levy or a supplement on non-domestic rates?
Deputy First Minister.
So in Public Health Scotland's evaluation of MUP, they found that while the sales data showed an overall increase in revenue from alcohol, it wasn't possible to determine the impact on profit. As I said earlier, in our Scottish, in the budget, we signalled our intention to explore the reintroduction of a non-domestic rates public health supplement for large retailers in advance of the next Scottish budget, similar to the alcohol levy that Alcohol Focus has called for. However, what I also said earlier was it will continue to engage with all stakeholders, and in particular retailers, as part of the exploratory work. And they need to look at that wider picture of other pressures and demands and that will be put on the retail sector.
Willie Rennie to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
One of the first decisions I took when I became leader of the Scottish Liberal Democrats was to reverse our party's previous opposition to the policy. So I'm really pleased that the government's increased it to 65 pence. I think the supporting evidence is pretty compelling. But can the Cabinet Secretary try to understand those opponents of the policy that seem to imply from their arguments that making alcohol cheaper will somehow deal with alcohol harm in this country?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, first of all, can I welcome Willie Rennie's comments? And I think the fact that he was actually honest enough to say that there was a change of position shows that sometimes on issues as important as this, you have to try and take the politics and the instinct of politics out of it. And I absolutely pay tribute to Willie Rennie for doing that. I have to agree with him. I cannot understand how there is any proposition, not least from those who have got a medical background, to say that making alcohol cheaper would reduce alcohol-related harm. That, to me, does not stand up to scrutiny. It does not stand up to the evidence. And I think the public health experts have made very clear the links between price and alcohol consumption.
Thank you. I'm not going to be able to get in everybody that wants to ask a question. That is already obvious, but I'm going to have to ask for briefer questions and briefer responses. Evelyn Tweed, to be followed by Sue Webber.
Some professionals reflected that reduced affordability was driving individuals to seek treatment. What steps is the government taking to ensure that treatment is widely available to those who need it?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, I agree that we need to ensure that there is access to treatment for those who need it. And that's why, as I mentioned earlier, over £112 million will be made available to alcohol and drug partnerships to support initiatives ensuring that local services can respond. We've asked, as I said, Public Health Scotland to investigate current trends in relation to the numbers of referrals to alcohol treatment services. And we need to make sure that referrals are made wherever appropriate and that there's capacity within services to meet people's needs. And that's why that review is so important. And I'll make sure that members are kept informed of that review going forward.
Thank you. Sue Webber, to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Back to an evidence-led approach, Deputy First Minister, and the evidence from your very own Scottish Government feedback report is stark that MUP has had a negative impact, and I quote, on those who are dependent on alcohol. Deputy First Minister, the Scottish Government has until the 30th September to consider some mitigations for this group, and the clock is already ticking. Your report only says it continues to consider how it can provide support. So what mitigations are being planned and or considered to help this group who
Deputy
will be further
First
harmed?
Deputy First Minister.
So MUP is, of course, a whole population policy with a particular focus on hazardous and harmful drinkers. Those that are classed as dependent drinkers fall within the extreme end of the harmful drinking category. And given the clinical needs of this particular group of dependent drinkers, MUP alone was not intended as a key intervention to address the needs of this group. As I said earlier on, treatment and care services are critical for this group, and that is why that range of services needs to be available, and that is what we will continue to do.
Gillian Mackay, to be followed by Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and could I join others in wishing Ellen Whittam well. I welcome the announcement from the Cabinet Secretary that minimum unit price will be raised, and while minimum unit pricing is having an effect, retailers are pocketing any profit generated. I welcome the inclusion of a public health levy in the budget, and at committee we heard that this is a potential win-win for public health. Can the Deputy First Minister outline the timeline for this work and whether she agrees with me that there is huge potential benefit for services in recouping this money?
Deputy First Minister.
So, as I said earlier on to others, it is important that we consult with all stakeholders, those obviously in favour, public health organisations clearly are, but also that we take account of the views of retailers, and that is what we will also do to make sure we've got good engagement across the board. So obviously the commitment was to consider well in advance of the budget process for 25-26. We're at the foothills of that, and of course there'll be lots of opportunity for parliamentary engagement on this matter.
Thank you, and Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We all know that alcohol is a major problem for this country, and I have to say I find some of the line of questioning from the Tories today just quite dangerous, actually. Presiding Officer, as we have heard, evidence from Public Health Scotland's evaluation of the impact of the policy is that it has had a positive impact on health outcomes, reducing deaths directly caused by alcohol consumption as well as hospital admissions. So can the Cabinet Secretary give any update at all as regarding what assessment the Scottish Government has made of these findings and also of any research into the financial impacts
of the... As briefly as possible, Deputy First Minister.
So, of course, Scottish Ministers considered these evaluation findings very carefully in reaching our decision on MUP. They are as a result of a robust evaluation of the period considered by PHS in their report. It's our assessment that, given the evidence, MUP will continue to deliver a reduction in health harms caused by alcohol at the increased unit price of 65 pence. And we know the devastating impact alcohol can have on families and communities, and it can be difficult to attribute a monetary value to this, but PHS evaluation estimated that the social value of deaths wholly attributable to alcohol averted by MUP to be between approximately 134 million to 469 million for the period considered.
Thank you. And again, with apologies, I was not able to call. That concludes the business on the statement. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change.